I had a real problem last Saturday night. It was in the state of Ohio. It was 31 degrees. Kept me awake all night long. It's chilly. Yeah. Oh my, it was very, very chilly. Next Sabbath, we will be having communion. So, next Sabbath will be communion. Let's go ahead and kneel for prayer. Dear Father in heaven, thank you for your amazing love to each one of us. Thank you for the ways through this last week that you have manifest to us your enduring love, your amazing compassion, and your strength. We just pray this morning for the Holy Spirit to impress, to rivet your truth forever in our hearts and minds. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I'd like to take a look at a few promises this morning before we, as we get started. Job chapter 33. I'd like to go in some places where we may not have been reading or studying this week. There's some beautiful gems of promise that we find in Scripture. In some very remote places. Job chapter 33. Of course, Job's first three buddies hadn't given him very much encouragement. And so then it fell to a fourth young man. His name was Elihu. And these were the words that Elihu spoke. How precious. Job chapter 33, beginning with verse 24. It says, "Then he is gracious unto him and saith, deliver him from going down to the pit. I have found a ransom. His flesh shall be fresher than a child's. He shall return to the days of his youth. He shall pray unto God. He will be favorable unto him. He shall see his face with joy. For he will render unto man his righteousness. He looketh upon men, and if any say, I have sinned and perverted that which was right, and it profited me not, he will deliver his soul from going into the pit, and his life shall see the light. Lo, all these things worketh God oftentimes with man, to bring back his soul from the pit, to be enlightened with the light of the living." How many times have we stood at the edge of a bottomless pit because of choices that we have made? And we look over into a pit and we're about ready to take a plunge. And God says, "No, no. Deliver him from going down into the pit." Because God had found a ransom. And who was the one who would ransom man from going into the pit, the bottomless pit? Who was it that ransomed humanity? Christ himself. Christ himself. And of course, verse 26 says, "He shall pray to God. God will be favorable to him. Man will see God's face with joy, for he will render unto man his righteousness. Now obviously the render or rendering that Reggie and Angela, I guess Reggie talked about that exclusively this morning, that rendering is far different from the rendering that God gives to man. He renders, he gives back to man something that man does not have in and of himself. We do not have righteousness within ourselves. But I praise God this morning that he grants, he gives, he renders to us something that is not ours by nature. And that's righteousness. That can keep us from going into the pit where there is no hope and there is no life. So I praise God this morning that he gives to us his righteousness to enable us to do what we cannot. All right, sweetie, let's take a look. We're in Ezekiel part 9. We're going to look this morning in Ezekiel chapter 16. If you'd like, hopefully you have your Bibles, you can open them to Ezekiel chapter 16. Due to the length of this chapter, this is the only one we're going to look at this morning. And in fact, we won't even get through the entire chapter. Ezekiel chapter 16 has nearly, well, it's got 63 verses. I think we're going to cover half. And in 3 weeks, God willing, we will take a look in Ezekiel 16 and 17, the rest of the chapter. But Ezekiel 16 this morning, verses 1 through 3. The Bible says, "The word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, cause Jerusalem to know her abominations." And of course, Jerusalem in the book of Ezekiel, as well as throughout all Scripture, represents whom? God's people. Absolutely. Spiritual Israel. And so Ezekiel is told to cause God's people to know her abominations. And say, "Thus saith the Lord God unto Jerusalem, thy birth and thy nativity is of the land of Canaan. Thy father was an Amorite, thy mother an Hittite." Now, why would God want us to know our abominations? Does that build self-esteem? What's that, David? To help correct them, okay? To help correct us? If we know what we are really like, then we will be very reticent about trusting in ourselves, won't we? So God lets us know what we're really like so that we'll learn to trust him. Now, what's all this about? Thy father was an Amorite, thy mother an Hittite. Who were the Amorites and the Hittites? Were they God's people? They were heathen. They were gross heathens. What was the ancestry of the children of Israel? Heathenism. Heathenism. Why would God be pointing out to the children of Israel, "You came from heathenism"? Why is that? Next slide. What's God trying to say? The ancestral lineage of the Jews was anything but auspicious. The father of the Jews was Abram, and he was a pure heathen. He came from nothing, but God chose him to be the head of a great nation. The Lord was trying to tell the Jews that he had done great things for them, totally unworthy of all his goodness. Now, can any of us think back to where we came from? To what we were? I know I came from a concrete jungle called San Jose, California. I was an idolater. involved in all kinds of things. All kinds of things. It's good for us sometimes to think back where we came from and where we are today. It teaches us two things. Number one, that we have nothing in ourselves of which we can boast. Nothing in which we can look and say, I've arrived. Or as Nebuchadnezzar said in Daniel chapter 4, he said, is not this great Babylon that I have built? See, when we think back, friends, from where we came from, there is nothing in us in which we can boast. And I think that's God's point in through Ezekiel telling his people, your pop was an Amorite, your mom a Hittite. Don't ever forget where you came from. Don't ever forget how good God has been to bring you to where you are today. Yes, ma'am. Great point, Pat. Pat's point was is that when we recognize where we have come from, it gives us a humble picture of ourselves, and it enables us, hopefully, to be gentle and compassionate upon others with whom we seek to share the truth. That's a great point, Pat. This knowledge should leave us in an absolutely humble position in the way we deal with others. No doubts. No doubts. Great point, Pat. We came from nothingness. Came from nothingness. But God, in His intense mercy, has given us so much, has given us the spirit of prophecy, has given us an understanding of Bible truth, has given us an understanding of end time events to help us understand where we are. Any of that in which we can boast? Yeah, there's one thing in which we can boast. What is that? What is it that we can boast in? In Jesus Christ Himself, Oliver, that's right. As Paul said in Galatians 6, he said, but God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of my Lord Jesus Christ. We have nothing else in which to boast, friends, but in what Christ has done and in what He is willing to do for us today. Next slide. Ezekiel goes on, verses 3 to 6. As for thy nativity, and of course, nativity means when you were born. In the day that thou wast born, thy navel was not cut, neither wast thou washed in water to supple thee. Thou wast not salted at all, nor swaddled at all. None I pitied thee to do any of these unto thee, to have compassion upon thee. But thou wast cast out in the open field to the loathing of thy person in the day that thou wast born. What an auspicious debut, huh? When Israel was born, they were born in heathenism. They were nothingness. Nobody cared. Nobody cared about Abram and Sarai. Nobody had pity. There was no compassion. And when I passed by thee, now here the Lord enters the story. He enters the picture of Israel's history, but also of our personal history. When I passed by thee and saw thee polluted in thine own blood, I said unto thee, when thou wast in thy blood, live. Yea, I said unto thee, when thou wast in thy blood, live. Let's think back in our own lives. I remember when I first realized that there was a God. My life was a shambles. Oh yeah, I was a successful athlete and I got all kinds of awards in high school. But my life inside was a mess. Just a mess. Slave to sin. Slave to wrongdoing. Family was in shambles. But God revealed His love, His steadfast compassion to a nobody. How good, how great. God sees us in our struggles and in our challenges, in our sins, and He says, live. I've got a better plan. I've got a better plan for you. Praise God this morning. Next slide, sweetie. Historically speaking, Great Controversy, pages 18 and 19 tell us that the history of more than 1,000 years of God's special favor and guardian care manifest to the chosen people was open to the eye of Jesus. This is on the Mount of Olives. Jesus is weeping. He's in convulsions. There was Mount Moriah where the Son of Promise, an unresisting victim, had been bound to the altar, emblem of the offering of the Son of God. There the covenant of blessing, the glorious messianic promise, had been confirmed to the Father of the faithful. There the flames of the sacrifice ascending to heaven from the threshing floor of Ornan had turned aside the sword of the destroying angel, fitting symbol of the Savior's sacrifice and mediation for guilty men. So there were all these reminders as Jesus was at the Mount of Olives, 1,000 years of what God had tried to do to reach a wayward people. It's all summed up right there in Ezekiel chapter 16. Ezekiel, show my people all that I have done for them. All that I have done. Next slide. It tells us, Ezekiel 16 tells us of how God would run after His people. All of mankind, for that matter. All of mankind was wrapped up. And here is humanity. Time after time, the song says, I was searching for peace in some void, trying to blame all my ills on this world I was in. You know, as we've talked before in Ezekiel, I think we did just last time I was here. We try to find blame for the ills in our own hearts. Folk, let's come clean. It's not anybody else's fault. Adam said, you know, God said, Adam, what have you done? And Adam said, well, it's the woman's fault. No, it's not the woman's fault. It's your fault. It's my fault. Absolutely, Nellie. And then Eve, she lays it bare and she says, the serpent, which you made, tricked me. God, it's your fault. Folk, true repentance involves us coming clean and saying, it's nobody else's fault. It's my fault. I did wrong. And folk, until we get to that place, God can never heal us. Never will experience the healing touch of God until we come clean and say, it's my fault. I'm wrong. I sinned. We've got to get to that place. The song goes on, surface relationships used me till I was done in. But all the while someone was begging to free me from sin. And God says, I was there all the time. He was there all the time. He was there all the time, waiting patiently in line. He was there all the time, waiting to bestow upon us His gifts. His gifts. Next slide. Ezekiel 16, 7 to 10, God then describes and says what the gift was that made all the difference for ancient Adventism. I have caused thee to multiply as the bud of the field, the expansion of the chosen people. Thou hast increased and waxed great. Thou art come to excellent ornaments. Thy breasts are fashioned. Thine hair is grown, whereas thou wast naked and bare. Now when I passed by thee and looked upon thee, behold, thy time was the time of love. I spread my skirt over thee and covered thy nakedness. Yea, I swear unto thee and entered into a covenant with thee, saith the Lord God, and thou becamest mine. Then washed I thee with water. I thoroughly washed away thy blood from thee. I anointed thee with oil. There's the presence and power of the Holy Spirit, the oil. I clothed thee also with broidered work and shod thee with badger's skin, and I girded thee about with fine linen, and I covered thee with silk. Well, this is the story of the history of Laodicea, isn't it? That thou knowest not that thou art miserable, wretched, poor, blind, and naked. And so what does God offer to His children? What does He offer to you and to me today? He says, I will clothe you with fine linen, and I covered thee with silk. This is the greatest gift, friends, that God has ever given to a group of people, to all humanity, His righteousness. His righteousness right here. The Bible calls it white raiment. The Bible calls it the garment of righteousness. Next slide. As we read in Job 33, 24 to 26, all the world stood at the edge of this bottomless pit, ready to go down inside without hope, without life, heading to an eternal death that would never end. But the righteousness of Christ plucks man from disappearing into that bottomless pit. Then He is gracious to him and say, deliver him from going down to the pit. I have found a ransom. I remember as a child being afraid of a bottomless pit. Because I remember as a child watching programs on TV where, you know, somebody would be backing up and they'd be scared and somebody else would be coming forward towards them with a gun. And then, you know, all of a sudden they get right to the precipice. And then somehow they were delivered. But it always petrified me that somebody wouldn't deliver me and I'd go into the pit and I would disappear. Well, folk, that's where sin will take us, is into the bottomless pit. But the Bible says that we can pray to God, that God will be favorable to us, that we can see His face with joy, because He will give to man a gift that he does not deserve. He will give us forgiveness for the past. And He will give us strength and power to not go into the pit. Praise God this morning. for that righteousness. Next slide. Desire of Ages, page 324, tells us we have only to neglect to ally ourselves with the kingdom of light. If we do not cooperate with the heavenly agency, Satan will take possession of the heart, will make it his abiding place. The only defense against evil is the indwelling of Christ in the heart through faith in his righteousness. So if this is the only way that we can be delivered from the natural carnal heart that we all possess, is to have Christ within, for us to have our minds focused on Christ, then what does the devil seek to do? He simply wants us to forget the goodness and power of God. If he can make us forget and we become dependent upon our own strength, then we're finished. We're finished. So that is why the devil invents unnumbered schemes to occupy our minds, so that we will not remember the goodness and power of God. Next slide. Isaiah 61, verse 10. He said, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, as a bride adorneth herself with her jewels. So God will clothe us. God will forgive us. The Bible says, as far as the east is from the west. How far away is the east from the west? It's forever, isn't it? It will never touch. The Bible says, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. That's pretty far, isn't it? Very, very far. God doesn't just forgive. God will empower us through the righteousness of Christ to resist evil. Therein, friends, is the gospel story. Right there. Next slide. Ezekiel goes on. I deck thee also with ornaments. I put bracelets upon thy hands, a chain on thy neck. I put a jewel on thy forehead, earrings in thine ears, and a beautiful crown upon thine head. Thus wast thou decked with gold and silver. Thy raiment was of fine linen, silk, broidered work. Thou didst eat fine flour, honey, and oil. Thou wast exceeding beautiful, and thou didst prosper into a kingdom. Now somebody may look at this passage and say, then why isn't that people don't wear, that we don't believe in jewelry? Well, folk, this passage is not about the fact that God told the Israelites they could wear jewelry and deck themselves with outward adornment. This is simply showing that God did everything to beautify his children. He did everything he could to make the Israelite nation the greatest nation on the face of the earth. Thy renown went forth among the heathen for thy beauty, for it was perfect through my comeliness, which I had put upon thee, saith the Lord God. Through the kingdoms of David and Solomon, the renown of the God of heaven and the Israelite nation went forth throughout all the world. God did everything possible to make the Jewish nation the greatest nation in the world. Next slide. Unfortunately, though, there is one big but. After all God did, the children of Israel forgot. Ezekiel 16:15-17 goes on and says, "But thou didst trust in thine own beauty, and playedst the harlot because of thy renown, and poured out thy fornications on everyone that passed by. His it was." Instead of remembering God, the children of Israel forgot him. And Solomon trusted in his own beauty, and all the kings, most of the kings after him, all the ones in the northern Israelite tribes, the two southern tribes, some kings remembered God, but most of them did not. So Israel forgot the presence of God. "Thy garments thou didst take, deckest thy high places with divers colors, played the harlot thereon. The like thing shall not come, neither shall it be so." So all the gifts that God gave to his people, they misused them. They gave them away. They united with the heathen all around them, and they started worshiping the idols of the heathen nations all around them. They forgot God. And the word that is used to describe the apostasy of God's people, God called them a harlot. Because you see, when God united with Israel, Israel was God's bride. We become his bride. And Israel forgot God and then created all these other things to satisfy their heart. And repeatedly in this passage and through the rest of Ezekiel 16, God refers to his people as a harlot. Next slide. Great Controversy 381. Go back, sweetie, to that last slide for a minute. When God's people became the harlot, this is what it did to the heart of God. That's what it did. It broke his heart. It broke his heart. Next slide. Great Controversy 381, it says in the Bible, "The sacred and enduring character of the relation that exists between Christ and his church is represented by the union of marriage. The Lord has joined his people to himself by a solemn covenant, he promising to be their God, they pledging themselves to be his and his alone. He declares, 'I will betroth thee unto me forever. I will betroth thee unto me in righteousness, in judgment, in loving kindness, and in mercies. I am married unto you.'" Jeremiah 3:14 says, and Paul employs the same figure in the New Testament. "I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ." 2 Corinthians 11:2. The unfaithfulness of the church to Christ in permitting her confidence and affection to be turned from him and allowing the love of worldly things to occupy the soul is likened to the violation of the marriage vow. The sin of Israel in departing from the Lord is presented under this figure, and the wonderful love of God, which they thus despised, is touchingly portrayed. Next slide. It got so bad, Ezekiel 16:20-24 says that God's professed people began taking their children and offering them to Moloch. And Moloch, of course, was the heathen god that had arms outstretched, fire beneath his arms, and the children of Israel would actually lay their children on those arms, and their children would then burn to a crisp. Horrible. Friends, the lengths that we are capable of going when we forget God is horrifying. Horrifying. And it's horrifying to see where God's people of old went. The Bible says, "Thou hast taken thy sons and thy daughters, whom thou hast borne to me, and these hast thou sacrificed unto them to be devoured. Is this of thy whoredoms a small matter, that thou hast slain my children, delivered them to cause them to pass through the fire for them? In all thine abominations and thy whoredoms, thou hast not remembered the days of thy youth." Here's the whole problem. You've forgotten where you came from. You've forgotten what God has done. "And it came to pass after all thy wickedness, woe, woe unto thee, saith the Lord God, that thou hast also built unto thee an eminent place and hast made thee an high place in every street." Next slide. There was Moloch. There was the heathen god Moloch. Arms outstretched, a baby being placed in his arms, then strapped down, and then the fire burns until the baby is roasted. Terrible, terrible. Why did all that happen? Because God's people, his professed people, forgot where they came from. In reviewing our past history, having traveled over every step of advance to our present standing, I can say, praise God. As I see what God has wrought, I am filled with astonishment and with confidence in Christ as leader. And then the prophet said, "We have nothing. We have nothing to fear for the future, except as we shall forget the way the Lord has led us and his teachings in our past history." If we don't forget, friends, what God has done for us, we have nothing to fear. Nothing to fear. The only thing we have to fear is that we will forget our Maker and our Redeemer. Next slide. Ezekiel 16, 25 to 27. We'll close. This is our second to last slide. Whenever God's people got into trouble, and here's where they were set up, right there along the shores of the eastern Mediterranean. When Babylon would come from the east, when the Syrians would come from the north, the escape route was typically going down here into Egypt. And in the days of Babylon and Nebuchadnezzar, as Nebuchadnezzar came over and came down from the north, God's professed people fled into Egypt. Instead of trusting in God, they trusted in an escape route. Ezekiel 16 says, "Thou hast built thy high place at every head of the way, hast made thy beauty to be abhorred, hast opened thy feet to everyone that passed by, and multiplied thy whoredoms. Thou hast also committed fornication with the Egyptians, thy neighbor, uniting with the heathen, and hast increased thy whoredoms to provoke me to anger. Therefore I have stretched out my hand over thee, have diminished thine ordinary food, delivered thee unto the will of them that hate thee, the daughters of the Philistines along the coast here. which are ashamed of thy lewd way. Friends, we can't forget. We can't forget how God has led us in the past and his teachings in our past history. In closing, one last slide. Great Controversy, page 608, describing the very day in which we are living right now. Ellen White foretells many of God's professed people forgetting their heritage, forgetting who they are and where they have come from, and how good God has been to his children. Great Controversy says, by uniting with the world and partaking of its spirit, they have come to view matters in nearly the same light. And when the test is brought, they are prepared to choose the easy, popular side. Folks, my prayer for us today, for you, for me, is that we will not forget. We will not forget the goodness of God in bringing us from heathenism, in bringing us to a knowledge of Christ and his righteousness. If we cling to that, if we hold on to Christ's righteousness, we have nothing to fear. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, thank you today for all your kindnesses, all your blessings, all your goodness in revealing Jesus to each one of us. Thank you so much that you have brought us from nothingness, that you brought us from the pits, and you've raised us up to do a great work for you in this world. Father, I pray that you would forgive us for all the times we have forgotten you. Forgive us, Lord, for all the times when we trust in our own feeble strength. I just pray, Father, that you would strengthen each one of us today to cling to the righteousness of Christ, wherein is power to do what we cannot. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.